evening, everybody, and welcome back to the ESL India Premiership Winter Season. Now, coming up next, we have Dota 2. We're going to have White Shadows going up against the Council. Now, the Council are from Bangladesh, and they've been performing pretty well. They had withdrawn from the ESL India Premiership in between, but now they are back, and they are very, very strong. Today, they play against White Shadows, who've been doing pretty well in the ESL India Premiership. They already won 4 games for themselves and are leading the charts right now in the Masters League. So, this is going to be a very interesting game, and I think you guys are going to be keen to watch this. It's going to be India versus Bangladesh coming up on your screens next. And we're going to see it live with our casters from the AFK Gaming studio. So let's head into the game with our casters from AFK Gaming. And I will see you all after that.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the ESL India Premiership. My name is Vivek, with me is Loki, and you're watching White Shadows on the Radiant facing off versus the Council on the Dire. White Shadows coming into this game with a little boost to their confidence, as they did manage to take a game of aggressive fire, who many consider to be one of the top teams in this league. How's it going, Flucky?
It's all good in the hood, man. So, looks like White Shadows, they respect the Council, they understand that they're a strong team, and yeah, they instantly ban out the Chin Visage,
yeah,
for which he's quite infamous for.
Mm-hmm.
I remember seeing a game on his Visage, I don't know when exactly, but he carried his team on his back, man. Like, he is fantastic on his Visage. His micro is perfect, his itemization is perfect, and his play is fabulous. So, looks like White Shadows, they respect the Council quite a lot, despite the win.
Yeah.
They pick up the clockwork for themselves.
Yep, definitely player-specific bans coming up from White Shadows. What's also interesting is that it's Jhin doing the draft for the Council. It usually isn't Jhin doing the draft. It's been a while since I've seen the Council play. I know their captain by his first name, and that's Rahib. And I assume Rahib is Kachu Khan Dansala. But yeah, they've also got 2 stand-ins, V4N and Deathseeker. I haven't seen either of them play in the past with the Council. I'm not sure what's going on with the roster. But yeah, it's a new Council, and it's Jhin leading the way. They open with the Shaman and the Sand King. Plenty of lockdown, good team fight, some push potential as well. It's possible that the Sand King might go to the offlane. The Council in the past are one of the few teams that does like their offlane Sand King. But with a little bit of time, we'll know for sure. Second pick on the board for White Shadows. No hesitation. They're going to go for the Winter Wyvern straight away.
Pretty interesting pick. The Council, they also respond to the first 2 picks very well. The Sand King, if he goes to the offlane and has to deal with the clockwork, he can very easily just Burrow Strike out of the cogs. And he can Sandstorm if he gets battery assaulted. So, using that, and using the fate time from the invisibility.
Hold on. If you Sandstorm during battery assault, the mini stun from battery assault will cancel your Sandstorm. But yeah.
No, but if you're invis and let's say they don't have detection, right? So he's battery assaulting in you and you immediately Sandstorm, you're going to be invisible and battery assault won't hit you. And after that, you have a small delay after you
Sandstorm. That's what you meant. Like, you use it to kind of move away if...
Yeah, move away from the clockwork and then maybe Burrow Strike away if that's not enough.
Right, yeah. True. Also, early on, if this is a roaming Sand King early on, the Burrow Strike range is a little less, so although he will Burrow Strike out of the cogs, I think in the process he might get pushed back and take some damage as well. But yeah, Sand King is one of those... sorry, elusive force / offlaners. And seeing 2 green heroes get banned out. And there's one of the 3 or 4 green heroes that doesn't get as much love as I think he deserves, and that's the Pugna. In my opinion, he'd do rather well for White Shadows versus the Sand King and the Shadow Shaman. Sand King channels his epicenter, that's immediately going to be tagged by the Nether Warden. Then if you have a blink, your blink's going to be disabled. Shadow Shaman takes around 300 mana or so to drop those Mass Serpent Wards. So provided you get the ward down first, White Shadows could be fighting with an advantage.
Yeah, but you don't really wanna first pick a core like Pugna because he is extremely squishy and he can very easily be countered by those cores. But he's actually quite good against the Sand King and Shadow Charm, so I wouldn't mind seeing it here.
Yeah, maybe certainly not straight away, but somewhere down the line.
Could be. I mean, they might look at it in the second pick phase, but they don't really have anything that goes super well with the Pugna right now. I mean, Clockwork, Winter Wyvern, they don't synergize with him. And Enchantress picked up throughout the council. So looks like that is... This is confusing to me because of late Enchantress has been being played as a core, and the Pugna pick response by White Shadows, who's super good against the Enchantress. Mm-hmm. So... Yeah, Enchantress, she's also a very strong roaming foe, and like the hero can do a lot of work if it is in the right hands. It can literally single-handedly win every single lane for you in the game almost.
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen Lil play to the Kiev Major, and oh my god, that thing was a miracle to watch. Like,
Lil in the Kiev Major. Yes, but I did you read the post about why he was winning?
No. What was the post about?
So basically, this was I think Kiev Major was a VPOG, right? Those are the finals.
Yep.
And VP kind of wanted to pick Enchantress very heavily versus OG, because OG at that time did prefer the Dazzle and the Trained, and there are two supports that aren't going to do much to the Enchantress, right? So the Enchantress does move into your lane. She can pretty much bully those supports single-handedly, and apparently Lil felt really confident on the Enchantress. As in, if you're the Enchantress this time around and you walk into a lane, you're definitely going to be taking a couple of hard hits from the Clockwork and the Winter Wyvern, provided they're there. But if you have two-way passive supports like the Dazzle and the Treant, who have no wave clear, who really can't man up versus an Enchantress and a couple of creeps, it's really hard.
Yeah, it can be difficult for them to
win these things. One of the reasons that the council did pick the Enchantress is because it's one of Jin's favorites. Are you noticing a pattern in all of Jin's favorites?
Yeah, all the zeros require really good and solid micro to execute.
There you go.
Yeah, so
he loves to micro. But it's a little surprising. I haven't seen him play the Arc Warden, and I have seen him play the Meepo once, but yeah.
I mean, Arc Warden is kind of different in the sense that where he's not that micro intensive, because most of the game you're gonna be sending your clone off to split push or to farm or wave or to like use Midas and stuff. But interesting picks coming out from the council here. So they opted for the sniper. We don't see that very often. And White Shadows respond with the Bloodseeker, who is potentially quite good against the Sniper. Once the dire lineup falls a little bit low, that is the Council, he can just rush in and like, just slash that Sniper to death and chop his head off.
Mm-hmm.
And the Pugna as well, super good against the heroes they have right now. The Sand King, the Shadow Shaman, as you mentioned earlier, he can cancel the Blink Dagger of the Sand King. He can cause a lot of trouble to Enchantress as well, because each and better shot is like 60 mana and Enchantress's HP pool is already quite low, so you don't want to be taking that. And Decapify 5 plus Nether Blast like literally just takes away half a HP, so...
Yeah, I mean, you might struggle to like physically hit the Enchantress, but the Pugna can just life drain away. They've got a fair amount of nukes, and it's a decent game to be a Pugna. I'm not entirely sold on the sniper pick. I don't know why they picked it up. I mean, are they reading this as a mid Pugna, and maybe in that sense sniper could do decent versus the Pugna?
I mean, if this is
in the lane at least.
Mm-hmm. And if this is indeed a mid Pugna, then I think the sniper does just fine, but I would be concerned if I was the site of the council. Like, he's gonna need a very fast hurricane pike against the clockwork, because if he gets hooked, he is gonna die. And a Zeus picked up for White Shadows here. So, I'm not sure, was it White Shadows that ran the offlane Zeus? The match we casted a week or so back?
Yeah, I'm not sure either. I'm really not sure. There's been so much Dota. I've been casting so many games, but I do remember an offlane Zeus, and an offlane Zeus that had very little impact. Huh.
I think it was White Shadows. I think it was White Shadows either playing with the offlanes who was playing against it. I'm not sure, but White Shadows was had something to do with that game. And then Ember Spirit picked up for the Council. We almost never see this hero in the current meta. He's actually quite decent against the Zeus, the Bloodseeker, the Pugna as well, Winter Wyvern as well. He doesn't have to worry too much about the Winter Wyvern ult being casted on his friends because he doesn't right-click damage, he does magical damage. Mm-hmm. So he's gonna, whoever gets Winter's Curse is most likely gonna be able to survive as long as the sniper's not in the vicinity.
Right.
Otherwise, you might just end up falling. Whose draft do you favor more right now? I'm a little on the fence about both of these drafts. They both seem to be decent against each other, but they both have some really massive pitfalls, which massive drawbacks rather, that can be exploited easily if played right. So I think if White Shadows, they get a good start on the clockwork and he hits level 6, life gets really, really hard for the Council. Play. But on the other hand, if the Council manage to get a few kills off and control the lanes very well, they can just translate that into pushes and everything, and it's gonna be a hard game. So a lot is gonna come down to who plays the early game better, White Shadows or the Council, and I'm curious to see what works out.
Yeah, I mean, this patch, which is thankfully ending soon enough, has all been about the battles of the four positions, and yeah, White Shadows, and as well as Jhin and the Enchantress. I mean, the Clockwork and the Enchantress, it's going to boil down to them in the laning phase. For now, Honolulu does get a couple of good wards off. The plan is to contest the offlane, and he's moving right there straight away. Jhin does have the slow, but I don't think a level 1 Barrow Strike in an Enchantress is going to cut it. In fact, Honolulu turns around. The Arctic Burn is there, so they're slowing down the Sand King. There's the Barrow Strike to run back to his own shrine. Snacks, holding on to skill point. White Shadows cause a little damage and also take some themselves.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, this is the offlane Sand King, as we talked about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And the Enchantress is going to be roaming, it looks like. She already has a smoke and a pair of boots. So she looks like she instantly wants to pressure the sniper. She doesn't want the sniper to have a good time because, sniper versus Ember, the matchup is a little hard for Ember. Because with the shrapnel, if you max the shrapnel.
Are you saying sniper versus Ember? Yeah,
my bad. I just saw they're on the same side.
Okay.
Yeah. So versus Ember.
Yeah, so it is an offlane Pugna. I'm okay with this. I'd rather have Pugna in the offlane than Zeus in the offlane.
Yeah, definitely. Pugna, he also has the boots, but I think this Pugna is going to have to be very careful about where he goes, because if he gets shackled, he's most certainly dead.
Yeah. The trick is to be far away and just leech how much ever EXP you can.
I agree with you. It's going to be interesting to see what timing the rain, at what time the Ember Spirit gets his raindrops. Raindrops are potentially a very good item against Zeus. If you use it right.
So I think you can get them only at the 3-minute mark, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Oh no.
Yeah, I saw that. Canceled. That Seeker, his Sal cancelled, his luck running short. He's gonna call out another Sal.
It's actually very, very bad for that Seeker here. That's actually gonna hurt his farm quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, in the offlane, Kachukan Dansala does turn around, does get the Barrow Strike, and secures first blood on the Bloodseeker. Honolulu might end up going down as well. And in your memory, well, he's trying his best with the Arctic Burn, but he's being controlled with that Barrow Strike. Jhin scores a triple kill, and this is why everybody targets Jhin when they play against the Council.
My goodness. It isn't even 2 minutes yet and he has already taken a triple kill. He had the Hellbit to work with. A slight misplay coming out from White Shadows. The Winter Ivan stood there too long thinking he could get the kill on the Enchantress, but he tanked a whole bunch of creeps and just ended up dying.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I can see why these guys respect Jhin so much. I mean, he is an amazing player, man. Wow, that triple kill. Nothing too much going on the map as of now. the top lane. Justice is doing fine. He's hit his level 3. About to complete his soul ring. 300 gold away from
him. I mean, Jin's a good player, but Honolulu does manage to bring him down with the double damage rune. He also broke his own cogs so that the Enchantress got pushed back by the cogs and ended up taking a fair amount of damage as well. And that's a lot of gold going towards the clockwork. 376 gold. That's
top lane.
Top lane. They're diving deep. The Nether Blast is there, but I am not sure what the Pugna is doing near the small camp. Ends up going down, but it is a kill going to the neutral creep. So Justice won't mind that too much. And there's action all over the map. The Winter Wyvern falls. Snacks giving chase. Sure, he's got the thirst, movement speed. You've got to respect Jin, though. Honolulu goes in with the cogs. Jin, he's going to turn around. And with the Butter Strike coming in from the Sand King, he's going to score a double kill.
Yeah.
So let me tell you how the Jin show works, because you're seeing this for the first time. I'm not sure if I mentioned this earlier, but the council love to run dual lanes, especially in the off lane. And off late, the dual lane involves Jin with one of his micro heavy creeps. He's just jungling aggressively, which is not something we've seen for a long time in Dota 2. He jungles aggressively, he wins a lane, and from there on, he pretty much single-handedly puts the entirety of his team on his back and carries them through.
Yeah.
And they're just going again. He's Butter Strike again. I know, they're going to show a little bit of restraint, a little bit of respect. But yeah, that's the Jin show for you. Snacks walks in. What is Snacks thinking?
Strike you down. Wow. I mean, I don't know. That was a huge misplay. He cannot afford to do that against a hero like Enchantress.
Mm-hmm.
She's already so close to a drum. She's 575 gold away from him.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
top lane, Honolulu. He's dived a tier 1 tower. Will manage to bring down the shaman, but will pay with his life. A kill that's split between the sniper and the shaman. I'm not sure that's worth it, but they're trying to run their own aggressive dual lane of sorts.
Yeah, and not really effective against the sniper, even though the clockwork is good against the sniper. It's not in the early levels, it's in the, when he hits his level 6, you can just hookshot on the sniper and make
yeah.
his life.
Maybe drop a blood right on the floor if you're the Bloodseeker and you're nearby. Look at this, they're going again. I've just left my camera on the bottom lane because Jin as well as the Sand King can't get enough of Snacks. The caustic unfortunately not working in their favor this time around. The Splinter Blast is there and Snacks, he's just getting more stacks of thirst. They're chasing down the Sand King. Snacks, well, he's a little slow, but he's got boots. And surely but slowly he will get the kill onto the Sand King.
Yeah, he didn't have mana there and he didn't back off. He decided to stick around for a while and Snacks made something out of that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Top lane, I'm surprised that once the Shadow Shaman was killed...
You know what? I'm sorry, Hiraka. You might never get to talk for the rest of the early game because Jin just keeps on going and going. This man has no restraint. And he's gone on to Snacks once more. With the Butter Strike coming out from the Sand King, there should be a kill. The Cold Embrace is there. Meanwhile, Justice falls on the other side of the map. Snacks staying alive, but low on HP. He's getting these thirst stacks, and the Sand King needs to respect that. Butter Strike number 2 will whiff. Jin wants to go in. He's got the Nature's Attendance, but only one point in it. He's near the Radiant Tier 1, and he's going to loop right back. Snack pops the stick, might get the kill, and gets a little bit of HP back. And now he's running after Jin. Meanwhile, Dark Knight falls, and Snacks, he's still giving chase. He wants the Enchantress. He's not got the movement speed anymore. But while all of this was happening, Pugna ended up dying. They lost the Zeus as well. And, White Shadows did manage to get a kill onto the Sand King. Not too bad.
Never mind. He went for the 2-2-1 as opposed to the 1-3-1 build, so he can't instantly just pop away flame guard. It looks like he paid for it with his life.
Yeah, I'm not too sold on putting points into Arc Lightning early on.
Neither am I.
In certain scenarios and matchups, it could work in your favor. I'm not sure if this was where he really needed to put that extra skill point. Look at this, Jin. He's got 2 Satyr Tormentors and there's a Butter Strike on the Winter Wyvern. Look at that! I mean,
double Hadouken.
Yeah, double Hadouken. The cogs are there. It's going to buy them some time. There's a sandstorm coming up from the Sand King, and Justice makes a rotation. Jin, I'm looking at Jin. Jin didn't do anything in that fight, but the creeps did all the work. He scores a double and he can go once more. The Hadoukens are coming off cooldown. Snacks, he's outnumbered. Actually, not really. Jin is outnumbered, and Snacks is giving chase. The Thundergrot's Wrath committed. The Hadouken coming off cooldown, but the creep has no mana. While Jin, with just a couple of auto attacks, will get the kill. He's running after Honolulu. The cogs will put a stop to this nonsense lane that Jin is running here.
Jin doesn't care though. Jin still wants the kill on the clockwork.
I mean, they're going again. Kachukan, Dansala has respawned. The offlane shrine is not available, but Honolulu is going to turn around. He did have the high ground, but he didn't have enough mana for the cogs. He's going to run after Jin. Jin has more than enough HP, a windlace. They're going to cut this clockwork, but surely and slowly, the clockwork will fall. The Baro Strike is there. Honolulu, though, saved by the Cold Embrace. They're turning this around. The Courier is AFK, while Jin manages to snipe it and turns around for the clockwork. Kachukan, Dansala, he's already switched targets. He's moved on towards the Winter Wyvern. Jin, well, he's not got too much mana. Splinter Blast onto the small camp, but here comes Snacks, who's had enough. Drops the Rupture, takes away the Unstoppable Streak, and puts a little bit of sense back to the safe lane. Pugna dies elsewhere on the map, while Honolulu is trying to find a kill in return. He's chasing down Van on the Shaman, and he should get this kill. While Snacks gets a double kill.
Yeah, and in the mid lane, the Zeus ended up falling again.
Okay. So, I mean, when the council plays, we need to make sure that we put forth this request that we get multiple observers. There is no way I catch all of that.
Yeah, absolutely no way. I agree with you. And the Enchantress, she kind of overstayed her welcome, but even then she ended up taking 2-3 people down. I'm surprised that White Shadows didn't decide to just completely sack the safe lane, let the Bloodseeker go jungle or something.
Mid lane, Ember. Well, he manages to get the Pugna. Honolulu watches his teammate die. Kachukan, Dansala did miss the Baro Strike, and Honolulu feels comfortable turning it around. Dark Knight with a quick burst, Ember, Remnants away, the Sand King. Can turn around in a bit. He has the Baro Strike coming off cooldown. Does manage to get the Baro Strike on the clockwork, but who's going to do the rest of the damage? The Thundergrod's Wrath from Zeus will ensure that the Ember will fall. Sand King, he's overcommitted. He's going to get the kill. Pops the Sandstorm. The Bolt is there, but Sand King, he's out of there.
Yes. Slight misplay by the Council. He got pushed back by the cogs, and he couldn't chain off. So that means that Sand King had to chase for that.
Okay, look at this. Jin is diving the safe lane tier 1 tower. Snacks, if it weren't for that thirst movement speed, he'd possibly be dead. He's trying to turn it around, gets the Rupture, but takes an impetus to the head. In your memory, wants to fight, didn't get the Cold Embrace off on the Bloodseeker the last time around. And Jin, he's running with the Rupture on top of him. The Nature's Attendance, 3 points in it, seems to make up for the damage he took. Meanwhile, Justice ends up falling. They're chasing the Shaman. It's Dark Knight, who's one hit away from bringing down the Shaman. And Van, he's just delaying the inevitable, ultimately ends up going down.
Yeah, you know what? This actually reminds me of VP so much. Whenever Little plays Enchantress, he's never a support. He's the core, man. He gets so much work done. And I mean, this guy, definitely not on the same level perhaps, but reminds me of the same thing.
Yeah, Jin is phenomenal on either one of these heroes. But there is a certain strength in the White Shadows lineup that we haven't seen just yet. Primarily because both of these heroes haven't been at the same place together. The Decryptify along with the Zeus can do ridiculous amounts of damage.
Yeah, that's true. Now that you pointed out. I even think it's worth going a Dagon on the Pugna, just for that reason.
Just burst down people. I like the Dagon, but I think he needs an Atos first. I mean, before the Atos, he needs to stay alive. There's a Shrapnel, there's an Assassinate, and with the Aether Shock, they'll get the kill. Meanwhile, it's an action-packed bottom lane here. Snacks being chased, Zeus trying to send back Jin and the Enchantress. Oh, Winter Wyvern going to TP Jin! Ah, he's been juked, and he's standing in the blood right, just runs right past it thanks to the drums. Ember joins the party, the chains are there under the Zeus, Jin with the impetus, and Ember gets the kill. Lots of killing spree taken away, Snacks dropping really low, Honolulu comes in with the cogs, Jin gets pushed back with the cogs, he pops the drums, he panics, and he dies to the rocket. Hookshot coming out from Honolulu, quick remnant forward from the Ember Spirit, he's gonna get the kill onto the Bloodseeker, And here comes the Sand King. Burrow Strike onto Honolulu. Has another Burrow Strike in 8 seconds. Ember wants to give chase. He has the chains. He sidesteps the cogs. And then looping around the clockwork. Kachukan Dansala. 1 second until his next Burrow Strike. He's going to try and do as much damage as possible. But he turns right back. What was that, Kachu? I don't know what that was. That should have been a kill. Anyway, he's going to get it. Honolulu turned right back. And ended up dying. Kachu, as well as the Ember still in the bottom lane. Decrypt Blast coming out from Justice. Kachu could go for another Burrow Strike in a couple of seconds. And why not? You got Jin in the vicinity. It's a kill either way. A double kill for the Sand King. And 12 minutes in, the Council are working with a 7,000 net worth advantage. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, it's Van being chased by the Winter Wyvern. Both the Fies, they're having their own side plot going on here.
He cancelled his, the Winter Wyvern cancelled Van's TP, but he just doesn't have the damage.
Oh, look at this. Honolulu's come in with the Battery Assault, but he's been immediately hexed and Burrow Strike. Anyway, Shaman, he's running towards the wrong shrine. He's going to end up going down. The Sand King dropping really low. The Thunder God's Wrath being pump faked. There's the hook shot. Thunder God's Wrath, along with the pushback from the cogs, will ensure that they get the kill onto the Sand King. It's Jin versus the world. And the world will fall one by one. He takes down the Winter Wyvern. Ember's there with the chains. They're moving on to the Zeus. Zeus dropping low, being brought down. Jin gets a double with the Impetus. They lose the Shaman. They lose the Sand King. But they get a Cold Zeus as well as a Winter Wyvern.
Council are gaining so much off the back of Jin. Do you look at the top lane? The tier 2 tower is gone. The Shadow Shaman, he didn't even commit wards for the first tower. He committed it for the second tower. And meanwhile, all that action was happening, they secured a tower for themselves and like just further enhanced their core lead, man. Beautiful stuff by Jin. Like, this is so entertaining to see.
Yeah, it's...
So these are the games you want to cast, man.
Yeah, the Council have always been entertaining, both inside and outside the game. They're a lot of fun. They play action-packed Dota.
Yeah, and Snax looks like he realizes that early on he has no chance of fighting against the lineup of the Council. Rightfully so, because they managed to get the lead as we talked about earlier. So he's just gonna go for the Midas right now.
So
look to come back towards the mid game.
There's something working in favor of White Shadows. Is that the Bloodseeker to some extent can scale, he has a lot of room to scale. With the Midas, he's going to keep farming at a decent pace. White Shadows are pushing back, but they're getting a tier 1, while on the other side of the map, Jin and Van with the Mars Serpent Wands and a couple of Skeletons are going to get a tier 2 tower.
Yeah, and the mid lane too is being pushed in, so looks like they don't want to give them any space at all. They just want to take the advantage that Jin created and just...
Oh, Honolulu goes in. He's got the hook shot onto the Sniper. Sniper pushed out of the cogs. If I'm not mistaken, that was his own 4-star. But look at that. Zeus with the damage. That Seeker, tagged by the Rupture, wants the Remnant back. But 4 heroes on top of him. Manages to Remnant further forward. Drops the chains. Remnant number 3. Low on HP. Low on lock. And finally, he's been brought down. Honolulu will get the kill. They get the Sniper. They get the Ember. But the Sand King on the top lane commits the Burrow Strike as well as the Epicenter and manages to bring down the Pugna. Honolulu and the Winter Wyvern chasing down Jin. They commit the Winter's Curse. Snax drops the Blood Rite. The cogs are there as well. This is pretty much a dead Enchantress. And the Sand King without an Epicenter can only watch his fellow teammate die.
Yeah, let's have a look at the net worth here and see how Jin is doing. Jin is above the Sniper in terms of net worth. And this is the safe lane Sniper, in fact, who had free farm pretty much for most of the lane and just died.
That doesn't speak very highly of the Sniper, actually. Snax with the Bloodseeker was contested and he's done a lot better in terms of net worth. Meanwhile, mid lane Ember goes in. He does have the chains along with the Sleight of Fish. Snax pops the BKB, wants to turn, drops the Rupture but dies to the Remnant. Deaths, MOM, 4 staff, wants to give chase, but nothing to really hold the Zeus in place.
The Sniper, he's done fine, I think, for his lane. I mean, as a Sniper, you don't have the ability to flash farm. And there weren't any stacks for him to take down with his Shrapnel either. He did go for the Mask of Madness build, however, which means his farm is also going to be fairly fast.
Yeah.
He's going to be farming, I think, almost at the pace of the Bloodseeker. And we can see that he's only a mere 200 net worth behind him currently at the moment. And that gap is just going to be less and less
throughout
the game.
Ember's done quite well for himself.
Yeah, Ember, he got himself a double kill. Not a double kill, but he killed the Zeus twice, I think, in the mid lane, and that was all by himself. So that really just propelled his early lead forward and helped Jhin do his crazy shenanigans in the bottom lane.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the council, the next move for them is to go Roshan with the right creeps and the Shadow Shaman wards and the sniper. They can very easily do Roshan.
I think the plan for the council is to just keep battling down the lane. Deathseeker goes in with the remnants. The cogs are there, but Jhin with the impetus eliminates the Zeus. Honolulu caught in the cogs. He's got the blade mail, but he's being slowed and controlled from Jhin, who's taking a lot of damage to the life drain as well as the nether ward, and ultimately goes down. Winter's Curse under the ember, and Deaths killing his own teammate. Deaths wants to turn around. The Baru strike, an absolute disaster. They've lost Jhin, and Snacks is on the hunt for more. He's running down the sniper. Deaths walks into the bloodline, walks right out, but it doesn't matter. Snacks has the damage, and he's going for more. Kachu can't dance, and I'm not sure Kachu can survive. Snacks, though, caught in the chains himself. The cold embrace to keep him alive. Beautiful stuff coming back from White Shadows. They've recovered a lot of the network deficit that they were up against, and now it's their turn to push.
Yeah, Like I said, this is going to be such an action-packed game. The advantage, they just nullified it right now, all the net worth that they had gained. I mean,
yeah,
nullified enough by 2k, but that doesn't
apologies. I didn't catch your last sentence.
They are up by 2k net worth, but it doesn't really mean squat when...
It doesn't. And, I mean, a lot of that net worth is because they've taken down so many towers. So it's not a huge advantage in terms of a single hero's items or any such thing. Also, some of these item choices are debatable.
And so are the talent choices. I mean, look at Pugna. He is deciding to go for the Yule sector, and for the level 10 talent as well, he decided to go for the +3 mana region. I mean, it's not bad by any means,
but
in a game like this, you really need the 225.
You know what? It isn't bad, but when you have arcane boots and a void stone, do you really need it? I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
I feel you're rather self-sufficient. I mean, come on. The only time you're going to spam blast after blast is when you're pushing a wave, and you'd much rather have that HP because you already invested in mana. You have arcane boots, a void stone, and a soul ring. Anyway, I missed out on a kill in the mid lane. Honolulu did TP in, and Van did manage to get the tower, however, with the Mars Serpent wards. So it seems as if Van tried to take the mid tier 1, committed the Mars Serpent wards. Did get the tower, but ended up dying. That's... I'm not sure if that's the best that they could do, but look at this. Honolulu, he's got the blade mail, but he's been surrounded. Jhin with the impetus. A killing spree taken away, and the goal going towards the Sand King, who's got his blink dagger up and going. That's on the sniper. He's got the four staff as well as the claymore, going for the shadow blade, which I'm not sure that's such a good idea versus the Bloodseeker. Either way. Hiroka? I have lost my co-caster. Loki, I cannot hear you. Okay. Anyway, mid lane, back to the game. Snacks caught with the butter strike, a quick Winter's Curse, and look at them go. Jhin almost kills his teammate. Honolulu will get the kill with a hook shot, and Snacks is chasing for more. He's moved on to the Sand King, and he's moving on to Jhin, who's been tanked by the rupture. He's running around like a headless chicken, and headless chickens bleed and die very quickly. A double kill for Snacks. Three heroes brought down from the side of the council, and that early game momentum and that push that they were working with suddenly comes to an abrupt halt. They might get the kill on the Pugna. I mean, they might, but they're not even getting that as well. Honolulu wants to move towards the bottom lane. He's got his blade mail complete. He can loop around Deaths, but Deaths does have the four staff. And yeah, Honolulu's gonna ensure that the sniper falls back. Ember, though, on the side. Low on mana, can't jaunt towards the remnant. Has been silenced by the blood rite. And Snacks brings him down. It's an unstoppable spree on the Bloodseeker. The net worth deficit only at 1,000 gold. White Shadows, they've clawed their way back into this game. And they're ready to push a tier 2 tower. And why not? I mean, I'd ideally hope that the Pugna was with them so that he could spam the Nether Blast. Oh, the Sand King's gone in. There's a quick Butter Strike, a hook shot onto Jin. The Cogs onto 2. Jin manages to force off himself. The Winter's Curse cast by the Winter Wyvern. But the Epicenter will ensure that this Zeus ends up falling. He's actually been denied. They're going in for more. Snacks does have the Shadow Blade, so he's just going to get out of there. They lose the Zeus. They lose the Clockwork. And they're not going to be too pleased with that.
I'm actually, I'm a little surprised that the Ember didn't go for a Hood of Defiance this game. I mean, the Hood of Defiance is vital. I'm no Envy fan, but sometimes I look at his itemization and I actually think that the way he itemizes is very, very, very smart. He always goes for the items that he needs and his team needs to make sure that he can continue doing his job.
Mm-hmm.
And Deathseeker, he's just decided to go for the Radiance and the Wheel of Discord. A very damage heavy build. I don't really think they need the damage as much right now. If he just went for the Hood of Defiance first and then maybe into the Radiance or Wheel of Discord, he would have a much easier time staying alive. And like I said, I'm no Envy fan.
Snacks controlled by the Butter Strike. The hookshot is there from Honolulu. Snacks being saved by the Cold Embrace, but the damage is magical and they'll get the kill courtesy of the Sandstorm on the Sand King. They're moving on to Honolulu. Honolulu initiated with the hookshot and probably regrets it right now. They manage to get the Shriek of the Bloodseeker. They commit the Mars Serpent Wards and they're possibly going to get a tier 2 tower on the back of this. Pugna, meanwhile, pushing the other side of the map, gets a tier 2 tower off his own. Who pushes quicker is the question.
The council need to go back. The Pugna pushes way quicker than these heroes, so they're already out of all the spells. They use the Mars Serpent Ward, they need to go defend the top lane right now. And looks like they're going to do that. The Ember Spirit is going to TP back. He's going to make sure the lane doesn't get pushed in, and Death's is there as well. I think, I mean, at least can you now go for Roshan the Council? I really want you guys to go Roshan. But
I mean, it's not an easy Roshan for them unless, yeah, Jin can probably tank it. Maybe get a couple of creeps as well.
Yeah, they could have actually done it very easily if any one of them had a medallion. Like with the Enchantress creeps, the Shaman Wards and the Sniper Mask of Madness. They can take that Roshan down fairly quickly, but looks like... Man, he just got picked off by...
Ooh, the Ember runs in. Snacks focusing the Enchantress. A Blood Rite on the floor. Deathseeker goes in with a couple of quick remnants and manages to bring down the Bloodseeker. Jin with the Impetus focusing the Zeus. Jin dropping rather low as well. And there's a Winter's Curse in the middle of that. Nobody's fallen just yet, but Death is pounding away on his teammate. Kachukan Dansala scores a double kill and Honolulu with the hook shot manages to bring down the Enchantress. A quick forced off to the low ground will ensure he survives. And he's making a run for it. The Sand King, 6 seconds until he has his blink online. It's a team fight that's usually swung in favor of the council. But Honolulu, I'm not sure if he's juked the Sand King or the Sand King juked himself.
Yeah, the clockwork a bit too late to the fight there. If he was a little early, that fight would have been completely different. I'm not sure what he was doing there. But if Snacks decides to go in like that, they all need to be there.
Yeah.
He just got bursted down by the remnants. And you, as a clockwork, you need to make sure that whatever follow-up is there on the enemy lineup, they can't do their thing. So even if the initiators get off a good spell, the follow-up isn't there immediately.
Mid lane, Mars Serpent Wards committed. The Shaman blinks back. It's only a Siege Creep and a couple of Mars Serpent Wards, which are going to be farmed indeed. The council... I mean... They have to win.
Because they just use their Mass Serpent Wards. It's on a 100 second cooldown now, and they can't push before that. The sniper is in no shape to take a high ground right now. He went for the Shadow Blade and Mask of Madness. He doesn't hit buildings very hard. He doesn't even have the Dragon Lance, otherwise, he could have at least hoped to just sit back and chip away at the tower bit by bit.
Yeah.
And then take in the shrines. But he didn't go for that route. He went for the Shadow Blade pickup, and I think he should be getting the Hurricane Pikeness. That's his item of choice here. Like, it allows them to siege, it helps them a lot against the clockwork as well.
Do you like the Shadow Blade pickup versus the Bloodseeker?
I can see
why. Versus the Bloodseeker and the Zeus?
Not really. I mean, in that regard, that Shadow Blade is very bad, but I can understand why he has the Shadow Blade. I think he just wants to prevent himself from taking like any of the clockwork damage. He doesn't want to reveal where he is in fights. He wants to pop up after the fight has started and like make sure the clockwork has already gone on somebody else by that time. So the Shadow okay. Blade, it helps with that. Make sure he doesn't get spotted out before the fight starts. And even though the Force Staff is there to relocate him, he doesn't necessarily want a Force Staff somewhere because then he's not going to have the right angle or the right approach to the fight. And he's going to have to hit a clockwork who I think already has a Blade Mail. And that's not what you want to do as a sniper.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can kind of agree with the Shadow Blade pickup, but not a lot. I would have really liked to see something like a Hurricane Pike into a Maelstrom, because it provides him with some damage. It also provides him some ability to farm in the meanwhile. Uh-huh. He does have the Mask of Madness, and it's going to be interesting to see what he picks up. He's just bought an ultimate top. Looks like it's going to be a Silver Edge, or perhaps an Eye of Skadi. But the Silver Edge...
So what, it removes Thirst Stacks? I don't know.
Yes. Yep, it removes Thirst Stacks completely. And now that you mention it, I remember Silver Edge is an item in the game, which is actually quite good against the Bloodseeker.
Okay.
It also lowers your damage output by 50%.
Yeah.
So you can hit the Bloodseeker with the Silver Edge, be ruptured, and take 50% less damage for 6 seconds. And that's actually huge if you communicate
that. And the Bloodseeker, I mean, if he has the Blood Rage upon him, he's going to be taking increased damage as well.
Yeah, exactly. So, I can see.
Oh, top lane. Pugna's going to take a lot of damage. But Honolulu with the hookshot from downtown. Make sure that the Pugna stays alive. The Nether Ward on the floor. A rupture onto Jin. They want the Enchantress. The Nether Ward doing its thing. But it's being focused by Deaths and taken away. Justice managed to go down to the Ember Spirit. And here comes the Epicenter. It clears the creep wave. While Snacks clears up Jin. Van in the trees. But look at this. Snacks has bigger targets in mind. In fact, he's absolutely utterly confused. His team is dropping on the sidelines. He'll drop the Blood Ride, which is going to ensure that he gets the kill onto the sniper, but the Mars Serpent Wards along with the Shackle will ensure he falls. Honolulu trying to bring down this Ember Spirit, and maybe with the Zeus and the Urn Charge, they'll eventually get him. But look at this. Zeus pops the Flame Guard, manages to bring down the Clockwork. The Clockwork's Blade Mail ensures the kill on the Ember Spirit, while Zeus cleans house and manages to bring down the Shaman. It's a fight that swung in favor of White Shadows, the gold going heavily in their favor.
What was that fight? It was all over the place. So the Sand King whiffed his Epicenter, it hit onto absolutely nothing. It hit a little bit on the Blade Mail Clockwork, which helped him in his own demise. He couldn't get the Baru Strike off, so that was unfortunate. If he could have gotten that off, he could have prevented that long and scrappy team fight. But he was silenced by the Blood Rite, so well played by the Bloodseeker Snacks on that part. And then Bloodseeker, once he ran out of his BKB, he decided to run again into the Shaman, who already had his wards, Shackle and Hex up. He arrived a bit late to the party, so he should have known that this is not a Shaman that you want to go up against when you're out of BKB. Because that's what happens, you're Blood Raged up, you're gonna get Hexed, you're gonna get Shackled, you're gonna have the wards pounding away at you, and you're just gonna die. Because Bloodseeker, he doesn't have a lot of armor, he has a little bit, but the Blood Rage, the amplification from it is actually insane. And Shin is dominated with a small centaur creep here, the one which gives you magic resistance. That can actually work out very well. If he dominates multiple of those, he can probably effectively lower the damage output by White Shadows by, I think, 20%? Yeah, by at least 20% if he manages to get 4 of those creeps from those centaur camps.
Or maybe he should have just gone for a pipe. Anyway, he's going for a BKB.
He could have gone for a pipe, but when you're the aggressor on any lineup, you really don't want to build items like pipe and stuff. You want to be the ones
I agree, but when there's so much magic damage on the side, how can you be an aggressor if you end up dying like that?
Yeah, that's where Eternal Envy playstyle comes in. He makes sure that his team has the items they need to make the lineup work, and that's where the Pipe of Insight on the Ember Spirit might have worked if he decided to sack the early Veil of Discord. I mean, he could have still gone for the Veil of Discord, a pretty decent item.
Oh, bottom lane, they've gone in on the Pugna, Blood Rite on the floor, Pugna needs to stay alive. The Nether Ward is there, they have vision, and look at them go. They've drained his life, they've bought him down with the Thunderbolt. Back lines, Honolulu's gone into Jin. Jin Well, he's caught in the cogs, he's trying to stay alive. Elsewhere, the Ember Spit's already fallen. And Snacks, he's got his BKB, he's running like a race car while Jane is killing his own teammate. Sniper dies to the Enchantress. Snacks needs to be careful. Van blinks in, he has the Hex, but White Shadows is right behind it. They're going to hopefully get the Shaman in response. In your memory, doesn't have the Cold Embrace for a bit. A Clockwork dies for the Shaman. And Shaman, I mean, he ensured that the Bloodseeker ended up going down. He ensured that the Clockwork ended up going down. And White Shadows are going to ensure that they get a tier 2 tower as well.
Okay, so that was a funny thing to watch. Winter Wyvern, he outplayed the Council a little bit by using his first skill, Arctic Burn, to take the tower down. But
yeah.
Shaman, he was quick on the counter. He used his watch to deny the tower. So he has some pretty sick stuff coming out there. Last fight, I want to talk about it a little about what the Ember Spirit did. So the Pugna used himself up, bought himself a little bit of time while he was getting gone on by the Ember Spirit. And for some reason, the Ember Spirit thought it's a good idea to triple remnant the Pugna when the Bloodseeker had BKB. And as soon as he did that, he was out of mana.
Yeah.
Because of the Nether Ward that was there. And he just got absolutely slashed. I don't know what the right term is. But yeah, he just got cut to death by the Bloodseeker.
He needs a defensive item.
He really, really needs a defensive item. Or he needs an item like Blink Dagger where he can
come in and
wait for his team to follow up. And then maybe when it's a good time to jump in, triple remnant and burst someone down. And that's actually a very crucial part of playing Ember. I play Ember a lot. And though it's not one of my, not a hero that I would say I am amazing or like insanely good or better than Deathseeker at, this is one thing I understand, that you really can't afford to throw in your remnants aggressively when there is so much damage and you don't have a BKB.
Yeah.
I mean, you can do that, but you need a BKB then.
Right. You need some way to stay inside the fight once you commit heavily into the fight.
Yeah, and that's why the Shiva's got such a popular icon.
What is going on? Kachu can't dance, Ala. I mean, Justice used his Yield Scepter and then the Sand King hits his Burrow Strike. That should have been a kill. But they have goofed up. Honolulu, I'm watching for his hook shot. He's holding on to it. He catches Jin. The Rupture as well as the Blood Rider. Quick Force Staff will ensure that Jin gets pushed back. Jin should eventually fall to Snacks. He's trying to do his best, but there's not much he can do. They cut the Sand King with the Yules. He's dropping low. In fact, he's been brought down. Justice brings down the Sand King on White Shadows, pushing with a wave of momentum. Snacks pushing the Ember back to his own base. They could possibly go high ground here or force out buybacks at the very least.
Yeah, very smart talent choice by Snacks over there. He decided to go for the 30 attack speed, which is really good against the ancient Tantris, over the 75 blood right damage, which is traditionally what you go for as a Bloodseeker. You don't go for the attack speed, you go for the blood right damage.
This,
because it's pure.
Oh, Honolulu, that is not your base friend, but sure, with the Nimbus on top of him, this should eliminate one of them. There's an instant buyback coming out from the Sand King. Honolulu tries to escape. The chains are there, but it's not enough. The Assassinate, though, will bring down the Clockwork. And Snacks, standing in Invis, burning to the Radiance, needs to be careful. Ember needs to be careful! He's been eliminated! The Nether Ward did its thing, and Death is killing his own teammate. Chachu can't dance, Sala. I don't think Chachu can survive as well. Dark Knight will get the kill with the Arc Lightning, and Barracks. The Barracks lay exposed in the top lane. Snacks, he's got the Blade Mail, a Glimmer Cape as well. It's Death's versus the world. His teammate Jin is respawning in a bit. The Council not committing their buybacks, but the range barracks have been taken. Jin and Deaths, they hit hard and they hit from range. Jin, he's looking to go in and get the slow off, but there's a Blood Rite on the floor! The Nimbus as well! Ouch.
Yeah, he used blood. He just got blood raged up as well. They realize that's a thing.
Okay, Justice. Come on, that's not your base, but he has the Yule Scepter. So, White Shadows are definitely baiting out a lot of spells from the Council, but I think it's safe to say that they need to retreat for now.
Yeah, they definitely need to. And the Ember Man is not respecting the magical damage output at all.
Yeah.
He is going for the Lincoln Sphere next.
I think it's too little too late.
Yeah, and I don't think the Lincoln Sphere cuts it. He, even at this point, I really wouldn't mind seeing a Pipe of Insight being picked up. It would make his life so much easier.
I don't know, man. At 36 minutes, would you rather get a Pipe or would you rather get a BKB?
I mean, it still helps your team out, so it's not a bad item entirely. Even
I mean, shouldn't someone who normally builds utility be building it? Like, does I don't know. I think maybe the Sand King, maybe the Enchantress, maybe the Shaman.
Yeah, but none of them were going for those items anyway, and I doubt you ever gonna have the farm on the heroes. Like, I mean, definitely you wanna see those items.
Dead Seeker's gone in. That.
My god.
That was so fast. And Ember down for 78 seconds. The hookshot from Honolulu, the Cogs, the Thunderbolt, the Thunder God's Wrath, the Nimbus, everything being thrown upon the Ember, and that's 70 seconds without him.
Yeah, he had a remnant out, but he wasn't quick enough on the trigger, I think.
Yeah, I mean, Decryptify plus Zeus is pain.
Yeah.
And now...
He went for the Flame Guard absorption talent as well, and despite that, he's dying to all this magical damage. I mean,
so,
that should just...
So, I mean, since... So, if I'm not mistaken, you haven't been a huge player of Dota 1?
Okay,
so let me take you in a trip down memory lane. Have you seen that meme where an old man is crying and he's telling his grandson, "Son, let me tell you a great story." I'm sure you've seen that meme. But one of the great stories of Dota 1 was Zeus and Pugna. So Dota 1 had many unique metas. One of them was dual lanes, and Nishant or Cloud X, his team used to run Zeus Pugna a lot, especially Pugna. It was a legit thing once upon a time, a dual offlane of sorts. But, oh, what was that Varro strike? Honolulu goes in, he's got the cogs, he's running after Jin. Jin hugs the shrine, pops his BKB, wants to fire. Justice bot down, Snacks dropping low. Honolulu in the midst of battle, but look at that, it's that Binder's curse. Jin, once again, being destroyed by his own teammate, while Ember, he's trying to make amends. He gets one kill onto the Zeus, manages to ensure that, excuse me, that the Winter Wyvern falls as well, and Snacks is forced to pop his BKB and run away.
Yeah, and... Oh boy, the Sand King, he missed two...
Barrow Strikes, yeah. So, my philosophy on Sand King is, epicenters are good, but if you're not getting the opportunity to hit great epicenters, at least hit multiple Barrow Strikes in the game. And he's not hitting one right now. Honolulu, he's been connecting those hook shots. Snacks is nearby. Honolulu is going to fall, Snacks is low on mana, but he has the butterfly, and with the Nimbus kicking in, Snacks has license to go ham. That's... He has the TP, he's going to TP away, and there's a regen rune in the river.
Oh wow, this is the best feeling in the world.
It is.
Just ganked a few people and you got a regen rune, no need to go back to the base, continue farming.
I think the best feeling in the world is a new patch, but this is close.
Yeah, this is pretty close.
Pretty close. But yeah, yep. Snacks, he's up to full HP and mana. He has a 7 second BKB, so still something to work with. They did manage to get the tier 3 in the mid lane. And White Shadows, they now have a 9,000 net worth advantage.
Yeah, as long as they kill the Sand King or the Shadow Shaman with that BKB, he's fine. Except when the Ember's not around. Like, if he just keeps doing what he's doing, jumping in aggressively with his remnants and expending them all, then yeah, Snacks has not a lot to worry about his BKB being cut short.
Mm-hmm.
And the ancient stack,
in your memory, Justice, or Justice caught with the Barrow Strike. This time he won't miss. Ember goes in, sure you have the decrypt, but come on, it's only an invitation for 3 quick remnants, but the Winter's Curse keeps the Pugna alive, ensures that the Sand King will nearly fall. Sand King whips another Barrow Strike, there's a Nimbus in the sky, and the Thunder God's Wrath as well. Snacks caught in the shackle, Pugna healing him up, the cold embrace as well, when he tried his darndest to bring down the Bloodseeker, but with no teammates alive other than Deaths, there's not much he can do. Deaths comes running into the party, he has that Shadow Blade, but Zeus knows where he is. The hook shot, what? They didn't go through the sniper and onto the Zeus.
No. Okay, so here's what happened. The clock. Oh, GG, well played call.
GG, well played. The council, I mean, I really want to give props to both teams here, because the council tried to do what they do best, run an offensive dual lane, give Jin something that works off the jungle, and try and dominate the game from there on. But White Shadows, despite having numerous deaths in the Bloodseeker, managed to come back. Beautiful stuff coming out from them. A lot of credit through the Zeus and the Bloodseeker. Some questionable itemization coming up from the Ember Spirit. I don't think we were both fans of what he went for.
Yeah. I want to point out that the last fight, The Yule Scepter by Pugna was completely sick. Just as the Remnant was about to hit, he Yules himself in the air. That's actually what saved him. And then the Winter's Curse is there to follow up.
Yeah.
So that fight just turned around completely. Sick play by the Pugna there. I mean, we were flaming his item build all along, but if you do that, then I don't mind your Yule Scepter at all, man.
Yeah. Anyway, folks, I think that's it as far as today's broadcast is concerned for Dota 2. My name is Vivek. With me was Loki. We're from AFK Gaming. I'm at facebook.com/VivekCasting. We'll be right back.